Welcome back, everybody, and welcome anew to those who are just joining. My name is Paul Colby. I'm director of the Intelligence Project at the Harvard Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs. We've spent an afternoon today talking about the intersection between intelligence, climate change, and global security. And we focused on the producer side of this. What can intelligence agencies do? What role do they play? What capabilities do they bring? What can the private sector contribute and bring? And how do those two work together? We want to spend a couple of minutes talking today about the consumer end of this. What are the requirements, the policymaker demands of the intelligence community and more broadly, wider intelligence capabilities to answer the key questions around climate-driven threats and risks? We are delighted to have today Special Presidential Envoy for Climate, John Kerry, former U.S. Secretary of State, former U.S. Senator from Massachusetts, U.S. Navy veteran, decorated combat veteran. We also have moderating the discussion today, Dr. Calder Walton, Belfer Intelligence Project Director of Research and the Deputy Director of the Belfer Center Applied History Program. Our main question today is to take a look at framing the question of what can U.S. policy expect from both the government intelligence community, U.S. intelligence community, transnational, and other institutions that may be able to provide reduce ambiguity and support decision-making. Calder, over to you.
Thanks so much, Paul. And thank you, Secretary Kerry, for joining us and carving out some of your time. I know how precious it is. And let's just say off from the outset that it seems to us the summit has been a tremendous success and a watershed, I'd like to say. I'm in particular struck by Avril Haines' comments, DNI Avril Haines' comments yesterday about how climate change needs to be now considered at the forefront of US foreign policy and national security. And it's really sort of at that, from that perspective, that I have one fundamental question for you, Secretary Kerry, which is, what are you looking for from the US intelligence community to better inform your decision-making and understanding about climate change as a national and international security threat?
There we go, unmute, sorry. It's great to be with you, thank you. And I'll try to cut to the core of this as fast as I can. What do I expect? I expect a lot more than where we are today. And I think Avril has appropriately put this squarely into the context of foreign policy and national security threat. We hear from everybody that the climate crisis is just that, but that it's also a national security threat. I mean, we just heard Secretary Austin heading a panel talking about the threat multiplier and the nature of the threat. We know that the climate crisis has the ability to be able to produce countless refugees, huge instability, food interruptions, food production interruptions. It becomes a cauldron for extremist organizing and proselytizing. It could even become an instrument in mass migrations of geostrategic manipulation of populations to go to war or do any number of things. I mean, there are any numbers of ways you can play this out. And just if you take the instability and disruption that is going to come from it, there isn't any leader in the course of the summit in the last couple of days that didn't say it isn't a threat to stability, potentially to geostrategic interests, but who knows on that. And obviously because of the resource dislocation, the water drying up in places, the changes in river flow. We had the president of Vietnam on, the prime minister of Vietnam, taltalking about what's happening to the Mekong Delta, that is the rice bowl for 20 million Vietnamese plus production that goes many other places. So if you add all these things up, you've got a problem, and you also have a problem for readiness of your armed forces, by the way. When I was when I was secretary, I went down to visit Norfolk Naval Base, briefed by two admirals, the admiral in charge of the base, so forth, and told us bluntly that they have force readiness challenges getting people to the ships. If there was a sudden emergency, we've got to move them. If there's a storm or flood or interruption. So there's so many different aspects in which climate presents, in reality, the existential threat that it has been described as. And if it is an existential threat, then it deals to be dealt with in the same way that other existential threats are dealt with. But we're not. We're not dealing with it even in non-threat terms as a realistic existential threat. So, you know, I look at the intel and I say to myself, I mean, here, this is the National Annual Threat Assessment of the U.S. Intelligence Community here. And I go to climate change and environmental degradation, and there's literally 6 paragraphs. That's it. That page is basically, it goes over to the next page with two lines right there. But, you know, what I want to know is two big things. One, I want to know how much that threat is real, how our intel, 17 different entities come together and say, this is the nature, this is really a threat. It's, in my judgment, the biggest non-state actor threat that there is. And if it is all the things that's been described as, we have a lot of planning to do. And we want to know a lot more than we know. But we don't even have the judgment of the intel community at this time of whether or not it is everything that's being cracked up to be. Would that help? I believe it would help. So there are two things I want. One, I want to know whether the judgments being made on which we're being asked to make decisions and to respond are, how legitimate are they? What does the intelligence community tell us about this prognosis, about the diversion of a river, or about the threat to the base in Norfolk? And the second thing I want to know is, if it is indeed the threat it is and we have to respond the way we say we're having to respond, I want the intel community to tell me as much as I know about my negotiations, as much as I can learn about what each country is in fact thinking, planning, willing to do. Are they taking it seriously? Are they gaming us? Are they in fact reducing? That's intelligence. That is intelligence. And we don't get that at all anywhere. There's nothing. We get kind of these very moderate assessments about, or really a regurgitation of some of the stuff that's in the newspapers rather than hard intelligence. So that would be the sort of two ways I would divide up intel needs is macro. Can the intel community be a counter to the denialists? Can the intel community be a bridge between us in this political divide we have today? Historically, the intel community is a very legitimate arbiter of those kinds of weighty judgments that are made. The people who sit on the intel community, and I sat as committee, and I sat on it in a period of time, tend to treat it with a different kind of respect for what the intel community says about something. So if the intel community were to say to a bunch of Republicans today, hey folks, here's the threat to your country and you guys better respond, would that change the way in fact it is dealt with on the Hill? And I know as a negotiator, I'd love to know what's the bottom line? What are you picking up? What's the human tell us? Is the negotiating strategy of these guys, are we gonna spend a week wasting our time, or is there, do you have any way of telling whether they're serious? That's the kind of input we got on the Iran nuclear agreement. That's the kind of intel we get for a nuclear threat agreement, or the START agreement. I think those are the two most important things. And I think Avril Haines is now gearing up to try to demand more from the community because it is now at the center of our foreign policy by executive order. But it remains to be seen how the 17 agencies really tackle it or organize themselves.
Well, John, it sounds like both Avril Haines has thrown down the gauntlet for a challenge for the US intelligence community, and now you too, as the key consumer has now thrown down.
Well, as a consumer, yeah. But I think this, I think the president would want to know if something is just baloney or if a country is misleading him. I mean, is Putin serious about doing this joint effort with respect to carbon and sequestration or space age, whatever, wherever he wants to go? Is President Xi hard, fast, determined just to hold on to his current track of emissions, or is there really a seriousness of purpose within the Chinese government, and who's playing what role? That's intel, and we could use a lot of it.
And on that exact point, Secretary Kerry, you've brought in international players, the geopolitics of this. What are your thoughts on intelligence sharing between different nations on this threat? It is a, we heard in the summit that it's a globalized challenge, requires globalized solutions.
Sure.
So what do you think about that intelligence?
Well, I think historically, look, we have our Five Eyes sharing process. And we're pretty, I think we're always very careful in the sharing that we do because we're always protecting sources and, methods. And that will not change, nor should it probably within an intel community. But it seems to me that there's in climate, there's a different kind of intel. And you still would want to protect your sources and methods, no question about it. And you should. But you could share judgments made off of some of the more public information and publicly gathered information. And if you have an intelligence assessment based on that, I think it would behoove you to share it. Or if you knew, for instance, that a certain country was planning to propose one thing in a negotiation but not do it, if you could find a way or do something else, if you found a way to do it again, protecting sources and methods, the intel community is pretty good at being able to do that. I think some information, let's say the intel community made a judgment that a particular proposal that was made in the public domain is, specious and whatever, they should put that out because that doesn't involve a source or method, but it involves an intel judgment. And if they have input that allows them to be able to make that judgment, I don't think there's a problem in disseminating it.
That's fascinating. One of the things that we talked about in the conference today, Secretary Kerry, was sort of having an international body that would perhaps, sort of blow the alarm bell in terms of countries, just as you just said, set out, that are not actually following through. So in other words, verification.
There's an element, obviously, Calder, of just policy decision-making in some of that. But policy is informed by what you know to be the relative, the facts and the strategy or overriding, game plan of a particular country. And always that is within the realm of what we call intelligence. People are trying to gather that intel and apply it to the policy. We don't do that in climate at all right now. There's none of that kind of impact. Climate has not yet, despite the talk about an existential threat, despite the implications in the context of a threat multiplier, despite the importance of the negotiations, the choices we will make, we do not get that kind of input relative to climate.
Wow. Caitlin, have we got any questions from the audience for Secretary Kerry? Have we got time? I know.
Who has to run in about 3 minutes. I apologize for that.
If there are any questions from the audience, I ask you at this point to please raise your hand. Our first question is from Graham Allerson. Graham, I'm allowing you to speak.
That's dangerous.
Honorable, how are you?
How are you, my friend? Great to see you. Great to be here.
So basically, One of the problems with having a deeply divided country, which shifts governments from about every 4 years, is making commitments that have credibility for 2030. So how do you think about that? And how do you think about persuading others that they should take our pledge, as opposed to fearing that a Republican administration, if it came back in 2024, would repeat Trump?
Yeah, Graham, that's a great question. And I obviously get that. And I've had that in a number of conversations around the world. And I have two principles and answers to it. First of all, even while Donald Trump was president and was opposed to proceeding forward on climate, the fact is that 1,000+ mayors in America and 37 governors and the DC and District of Columbia all stood up and said, we're staying in the Paris Agreement. And in effect, even while Trump was huffing and puffing without any science or facts about climate and said he was out of the agreement, we did cut emissions. We continued to pursue our renewable portfolio laws, and 75% of the new electricity that came online in America came from renewable sources. So, you know, it wasn't as bad as people pretend. But the bigger, much more critical answer to that question, why will this not change and why can you trust America? Because just a day or two ago, six banks said they're putting $4.16 trillion into a designated track of investment in climate initiative. And that is over a 10-year period. That the marketplace is moving so dominantly in this direction, looking for the holy grail of green hydrogen or for carbon store, direct air capture of carbon, or for battery storage more than 4 hours and so forth. The market is doing this. Why is Tesla the most valuable appraised car company in the world? Because it makes only one thing, electric cars, because that's where the market's going. General Motors has said by 2035, they will be only making electric cars. Mercedes, BMW, Volkswagen, everybody's moving in that direction. And no politician is going to come in 4 years from now with the trillions of dollars that are going to be invested and the transition of our economy that will be in full swing and suddenly undo that. And the reason that you can't undo it is it's being done for all the rational reasons, because we have to, because it's existential, because we have to, because we're gonna pay a huge price, according to every economist, more than doing it. It will cost more not to do it. And we're gonna do it because that's where the market is going to be and people are gonna make a lot of money in the doing of it. So I don't, and people accept that. I don't believe any politician, no matter how great a demagogue they are, can undo this transformation that is about to take place. And with that, I've got to run and get to the airport. I apologize.
No, it's been an absolute honor to have you join us, Secretary Kerry. I heard you lay down a challenge to the US intelligence community loud and clear. I would like to invite you back in a year's time to see if the USIC has stepped up to the challenge that you've set them.
Well, let's see. We're in principle, fine, but I'm not allowed to schedule myself anymore.
Anytime that you want. Secretary Kerry, thank you for joining
us. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.